Our scripture reading this evening comes from an interesting passage, and I'm going to use our red Pew Bibles. And so if you want to follow along with me in the Revised Standard Version, it is 1 Corinthians chapter 11, starting with verse 17, and believed by many that this might be the oldest actual written understanding of communion, even before the Gospels were written. The Apostle Paul's teaching. I remember us talking about that in seminary. Many of the scholars don't have the opportunity to find out exactly the dates of these different passages, but it is believed by many, as I said, that this might be the formula that was given that we follow even today from the Apostle Paul, even before the Gospels were recorded for others to read. It's a lengthy passage, but it's a passage that's misunderstood many times. But it's a powerful group of words of Holy Scripture, and I think it's very fitting, of course, for Maundy Thursday. It is again 1 Corinthians chapter 11, starting with verse 17. Now, in the following instructions, I do not commend you, because when you come together, it is not for the better, but for the worse. For to begin with, when you come together as a church, I hear that there are divisions among you. And to some extent, I believe it. Indeed, there have to be factions among you, for only so will it become clear who among you are genuine. When you come together, it is not really to eat the Lord's Supper. For when the time comes to eat, each of you goes ahead with your own supper, and one goes hungry and another becomes drunk. What? Do you not have homes to eat and drink in? Or do you show contempt for the church of God and humiliate those who have nothing? What should I say to you? Should I commend you? In this matter, I do not commend you. Verse 23. For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be answerable for the body and blood of the Lord. Examine yourselves, and only then eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For all who eat and drink without discerning the body, eat and drink judgment against themselves. For this reason, many of you are weak and ill, and some have died. But if we judged ourselves, we would not be judged. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are disciplined so that we may not be condemned along with the world. So then, my brothers and sisters, when you come together to eat, wait for one another. If you are hungry, eat at home, so that when you come together, it will not be for your condemnation. About the other things, I will give instructions when I come. Word of God for the people of God. He's a little leery to give thanks to God for that passage. Amen? My goodness gracious. You can see the Apostle Paul is struggling there with a group of folks, and you may or may not be aware of the dynamics that are developing there. In the early church, many times as they formed together, and the Corinthian community of believers was a dynamic, charismatic group of men and women that loved the Lord. And it was growing by leaps and bounds, but there were difficulties there like there is everywhere. It's not that there's difficulties in church, there's just difficulties in human nature. And so those just kind of roll over into the church setting. When he talks about eating, the struggle that's going on is that they would have a love feast, a gathering together in the homes, when they would gather together, and then they would share Holy Communion. So when they were not waiting for each other, and they would go ahead, which will be the A of our ABCs tonight, without thinking through what they were doing, discerning what they were doing, What he was referring to was the love feast where they actually had dinner together, maybe fried chicken together. I'm not sure what all the menu was like in that day, but some folks would be enjoying the fellowship. Others were taking advantage of it. Some were poor, some were wealthy. People began to talk back and forth, struggling with each other. Some would drink a little bit of wine. Some would drink way too much wine. So that by the time they got to the Lord's Supper, some of them were not thinking clearly. And so this got back to the Apostle Paul, and he said, I cannot commend you on this because you must discern the Lord's body before you take this sacrament. And if eating together is causing the struggle, he said, then probably you ought to eat at home and then just come together like we're doing tonight for the Lord's Supper. So I titled our meditation this evening, Wait. Wait. When I put that title together, I was reminded so clearly of Daddy and me as a little boy fishing. And we never fish like many of you where you have these beautiful boats and big engines and wonderful rod and reels. And we just had a cane pole on the bank or in an old boat and a cork and a line and a worm. And I remember us there as a boy fishing and the cork would start to bobble just a little bit. And boy, as a boy, I want to just yank it out like that. And Daddy would say, son, wait, until just the right time when the cork would go down. And then I just, shoom, like that, throw it way up in the air. Of course, Daddy had to teach me that it's a flip of the wrist, as we all know. I still haven't got that down pat, but that was the idea. Wait. The A of our ABCs today is that folks were going on ahead and taking of the sacrament when they weren't thinking it through. Or either they had too much wine and they were not able to think it through. It reminds me of King Saul in the Old Testament. If you remember, King Saul was dethroned, and yet his sins, when you compare them to King David, seem so small. I mean, David's sins were murder, adultery. And yet the Bible says he was a man after God's own heart. King Saul's sins didn't seem to weigh that way. King Saul would go ahead of the game. When Samuel was saying, wait, before you move forward, whatever the king was going to do, so that Samuel the prophet could come and bring, the priestly blessings, Saul just couldn't wait. He couldn't wait. And so he'd say, well, let me just do the blessing. Let me be the preacher. Let me be the priest, God is great. God is good. Let us thank him for our food. Amen. Let's go, guys. You see? And then Samuel would get there and he was already gone. The struggle, as I've studied that, of King Saul was his arrogance, his lack of humility, his lack of understanding to be patient and wait on the Lord. He just had no time for the Lord. David, in his great sins, when he realized his sinfulness, had all the time in the world for the Lord. And would cry out from the bottom of his heart, as we have in the book of Psalms, how sorrowful and weeping he was, just like Peter weeping when he denied the Lord. The B of our ABCs tonight is the body. The body. The Bible tells us in the Scriptures when they first had the Passover meal in the Old Testament, and that is recorded in Exodus chapter 12, verse 46, the Passover lamb, the preparation, that not a bone was to be broken. It was a pure lamb that was given for the glory of God. And you remember the concept of the ancient Passover in this passage of Exodus is when God was setting the people free from their 400 years of bondage, and the angel of death was bringing the judgment of God upon the Egyptians. If you remember the story from that great book of Exodus. And so they would take the lamb and they would sacrifice it. They would take the blood of the lamb, put it over the door facing, and not a bone of that animal was broken. It was cooked like that, whole. And then they would eat of that night with their belt on and their coat ready, and they were ready to go when God set them free. And the angel of death passed over them because of the blood, the covenant of the blood over their head. And so the prophecy then went as we know to Jesus, that not a bone would be broken. Again, it goes back to Exodus chapter 12, verse 46, and then it's lifted up in the book of Psalms by King David, Psalm 34, verse 20, where it says these words, "He protects his bones, not one of his bones shall be broken." And then, of course, dear friends, 1,000 years later, when Jesus is alive, we have John chapter 19, verse 36, where it proclaimed not a bone would be broken. When they went to make sure that he died upon the cross, do you remember? And they were going to break his legs because that's how they speedily killed those that were being crucified. They realized he had already given up the ghost. So they did not break his legs, fulfilling the scripture, the Lamb of God, perfect Lamb of God. But they did take the spear and thrust it through his side just to make sure that he was dead. And of course, he was. Now we say in Holy Communion, the body is broken for us. But please understand, it's not the bone. There's nothing of his physical body. The bones were not broken. But of course, the presence of God, who he was, and becoming sin, that is the concept of being broken and why we break the bread as we gather together for the Holy Sacrament. The C of our ABCs and a final letter of our devotion tonight is the cup of the Lord. Now, the ancient Seder that we come from, the Passover meal, there's nothing, when you go all the way back to the original Passover, about this holy cup. But by the time Jesus comes along, the Jewish tradition was to have in the Passover meal that Jesus was celebrating the night before his crucifixion, like we're doing tonight, and there were actually four cups throughout the meal that were offered. And this is fascinating. You may be very much aware of this. The first cup that was offered at the beginning of the meal was the cup of sanctification. Sanctification means set apart. The people of God were set apart from the world in which they lived, and so they would participate and remember that they were set apart. The second cup that was offered in the meal was to recognize the plagues in Exodus, where God was passing judgment, trying to set his people free, meaning again that God is holy and righteous. That's his greatest attribute. The third cup that is offered, it is actually after the meal, is the cup of redemption, that God redeemed them, the Lamb, the perfect Lamb would give its life. And then, of course, the fourth cup at the end was the Hallel cup, was the cup of praise for what God has done. And that's where our word hallelujah comes from, the cup of praise. It's interesting as you read in the Gospels the story and in the passage we've read tonight that when you offer this cup, when Jesus offered it, it was after this meal. After the meal was over, do you remember the passage? After the meal was over, the cup of the Lord was offered, meaning it was the third cup. And what was the third cup of the ancient Passover Seder meal? The cup of, yes, redemption. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that beautiful? I mean, it was all planned through the ancient stories. That's why we are considered Judaic Christians. The Old Testament, New Testament, Old Covenant, New Covenant, it comes together. Christ said, "I did not come to destroy any of the Old Testament, any of the law. I come to fulfill it. He that knew no sin became our sin and died on the old rugged cross." What about the passage, though, that says, if you take of this cup unworthily, that's why many of you are sick or ill and some have died. There's been a number of people down through the generations that are scared of taking the cup of the Lord, afraid that if they take it unworthily, they will die or they will be cursed. I want to guarantee you tonight there's no cursing in the sacrament of the Lord. No cursing. This is not magic. This is something we must always proclaim, that the faith of Jesus Christ is mystical, but it is not magical. It's not magic. Everything in the Bible, Old and New Testament, go against magic, but it is mystical, dear friends. What's actually being said, as I explained earlier, is that people were taking the sacrament in an unworthy manner, meaning they were not paying attention to the body and the blood of the Lord. They were just not able to intentionally pay attention, or maybe they had too much wine in their system and they were not thinking clearly. And so therefore, the reason that they were sick or ill and maybe dying too early was not because of the cup and the bread. It was that their lives were not living for the glory of God. And so they were straying away from God. And that was just an expression of them not living for the glory of God, you see. So what the scriptures require to be worthy of this is to think about it. We're all unworthy. We've all sinned. We've all come short of the glory of God. None of us in that light are worthy to partake, but Jesus has become the Passover lamb. And in this passage I read to you tonight, the concept, the context to be worthy is to say, Lord, I am a sinner. Please forgive me of my sins and cleanse me from all unrighteousness. And then the table is open for you and for me. And all of God's people said, Amen.